Hello, everyone out there on the internet. Here we are again at the, I don't want to call it like a casting couch. It's like a hacker couch.
Like, well, it is. It's
the hacker couch.
That's worse.
Yeah.
It's what we'll go with.
All right, let's move on.
This is a video showcasing our CTF from B-Sides Nova when we played the Capture the Flag competition there just this past weekend. Mm-hmm. It's Monday. Today's Monday.
Today is Monday.
And the CTF was Friday and Saturday. So we took first place, which was cool.
Should I pull up the thing?
Oh,
you got the thing?
I mean, why not?
Fell over. I can't reach it now.
Oh, damn it.
Well, you're going to do all that and you're not going to grab it?
Well, yeah. I don't want to, like, climb over.
Do it. Just climb over. He'll be back in a minute.
We won. That says $2,500,000.
That's how you read. please don't cash the check. I don't have an image of it now. So
we
know. We
already got
a joke. Hey. It was a joke.
We already got
a joke.
Okay.
So the game was King of the Hill style.
Yeah.
It was really fun. What was the guy who put it on?
Arash.
Arash.
The Hacker Ground CTF.
Yeah.
Yep.
Super good.
What this video is 9 hours or 10 hours or whatever I'm ever meant to time, footage that I sped up to 1600 times speed. So it looks like flashing and we have some basis to like actually make this video out of. So let's do it. Let's play the video. I'm going to put us over here and I can move us around if need be, but it's on the TV so we can watch it and talk about it. I'm like winded from getting this.
Yeah. You should do more cardio.
I guess so. How do I play the video? I don't computer very well. Okay. So, premise of the game, they put us in a network that had a couple machines surrounding us inside of it that we were to attack and break into. Here at the beginning, I'm just kind of taking inventory of what all those machines actually are, running my end map scan, seeing what challenges are actually asked of us, right? And I tried to put together some Discord communication so we could actually share all these end map scans and what we're finding, et cetera, et cetera. You might be able to see the CTFD challenges just spring up every now and again. I also went through looking at them, but really the task was to just break into each of these machines. There they go. They're just flying around and actually be able to hold them down. It was a King of the Hill style game, like Julian mentioned. So
yeah. So you mentioned that the CTFD. So the CTFD was there to submit flags. So once you got access to a machine, you could submit a flag and you got some points for the actual flag on the machine, but the majority of your points were going to come from holding that machine for a long period of time. And the CTFD didn't provide any prompts and say like, oh, do this on this machine. It just said, here's an IP address of a machine and submit a flag for it or a name of a machine.
And for those of you who aren't aware of what King of the Hill style CTFs are, there was like 8 or 9 servers, I don't remember how many, and you had to hack into them, but the other teams could hack into the same servers and kick you out. So not only were you doing attack, but you also had to do defense of the machines you just compromised. And so that way one team just didn't have the thing the entire game. Every like 2 hours, it was like rolling resets. So then whoever could hack back into it faster and reset up their persistence and re-kick everybody out got points. And then there's a capture binary that you ran with your points, your team name, and that basically gave you points.
Yeah, one of the big things is not just kicking other people out. That's great, and that's really good. And if you don't do that, they're just going to keep being annoying. But the other thing is patching whatever vulnerability that you got in through so they can't get in after that.
Unless you can kick them out another way. Because if you patch the vulnerability and lose your C2, then you've now...
Trevor's here!
Hi, Trevor!
Trevor, come join the video!
Okay.
That's our friend Trevor.
Oh,
Trevor
yeah.
was there, but he didn't play on our team.
Did
he was hanging
taquitos?
Out.
I did.
You brought taquitos? 7-Eleven taquitos.
Nice.
So anyways... we talked about how
so
we're doing.
You see right here on the screen, if you can pause it, John.
Yeah, man.
Right now,
in a minute,
this
so
one
you.
Took us way too long to figure out. This was a Java RMI one, so it was a deserialization one. And basically, like, this should have been a very simple, like, just used why so serial. And for the life of us, we could not figure out why it wasn't working. We didn't get it till day two. I think we were the only team who got it, too.
So part of the reason we didn't get it working, so why so serial has a lot of different payloads it can use. Specifically, this was an RMI server, and so that's a specific exploit that you can tell why so serial to use. You just have to tell what payload to use and then what command to run. So The problem was we didn't know what the machine was. For example, John tried it for a long time using Ping, which theoretically should work no matter what type of machine it is, like Windows or Linux. I, for some reason, in my own stupidity, like just assumed it was a Windows box, and I was trying to run other things, and none of it would work. Julian ended up getting it to work because he was like, no, this is a Linux box, man. and so he ended up getting it to work. It ended up just being the command we run. But one thing we had talked about was just trying to create something for this type of thing to just automatically run through the payloads and try all those payloads for both Windows and Linux type of commands and then see which one works. I kind of did a little bit of that, but stupidly assumed it was Windows the whole time. So
you could see me like looking at IPsec videos when I see him done like a YSO serial Java RMI exploit, and I was trying that syntax and whatever. But yeah, it'd be cool to like weaponize something that'll try all the payloads and then just be able to figure it out and know when it's actually got some response back to it.
The easiest way we were talking about earlier to do that, I think, would probably be the same thing you did and the same thing you tried to do is run Ping. But there's some little caveats in there you'd have to do. I was talking about earlier, I think you could do it with just like Scapy and Python. You could start the capture in a separate thread and then send the payload, stop the capture, check for ICMP packets.
Yeah, the only reason I knew it was Linux was I pinged myself and I didn't see it stop pinging myself. So yeah. I knew that meant it was either Mac or Linux, and Linux was more likely. So.
Nice. Yeah, I had used Ping with Attack C, knowing that, hey, maybe that will stop it because if it goes in an infinite loop, that could be very well be bad. But I think I literally used a hyphen C rather than a forward slash C or whatever the syntax is on Windows, because I just couldn't. I don't know. I didn't get it right, but
that was a fun one.
Yeah, that one was really cool. You also found the what was it? It was Bluekeep.
Yeah,
I've been doing a ton of research on Eternal Blue because one of the boxes had linked to in their CTF challenge had linked to literally the Blue song by like Eiffel 65. That's exactly right. And Eternal Blue wasn't right because SMB was filtered, and we were like, is SMB supposed to be filtered? And then you found a different machine that we literally had no idea was even on the network. Like, I don't know what happened.
When we pinged it at first, or it didn't respond to ping at first, and it didn't end map right unless you threw a TACPN on there. But then when you actually did this, whatever that mode is, the assume it's down mode.
Oh, yeah, TACPN, right.
Then it responded as 3389 open, and Bluekeep made sense. And it was nice because not only it didn't, whatever Windows 7 box he implemented, he made it work with the default set one payload or set target one in Metasploit. You didn't have to try to guess which hypervisor it was on to figure out what box you had in Bluekeep.
Now, Bluekeep is really unstable, right?
Yes.
So did you have to do anything special or fancy to figure out the parameters? Or if you had to do that, what would you do? I don't know a lot about Bluekeep personally.
Past experiences, it's very touchy on the groom size. I think the default one for Meterpreter or Metasploit is 250 megabytes. In practice, if you set your groom size to 50, don't know why it makes it more stable, but it does. The other thing you can do is if you're setting up your own range, basically, like if you're running it in a virtual machine, if you take your virtual memory and use recall to figure out what the offset should be, then you can get the exact offset you need to set to your thing. And if you Google this, there's more stuff online on how to do it. But I've had to do that before setting up my own range where you find what offset and you pass that, edit the backend Ruby script for Metasploit. That way it's not just your regular default ones. You can actually put in your own custom one. That works. But luckily he made it work with one of the default Metasploit exploits.
Okay.
Let me talk about some of the stuff that's flying around on the screen, because once we got onto some of the boxes, I was doing like really dirty.
You know, pause
kinda,
it.
Oh, sure. I don't know if it's visible. Well, but I had written some stupid scripts to stop all other people's capture. Like, they would run their capture program and it would just fail, or I would want to kill it as soon as I saw it, or if it was like running in the processes. And I went ahead and would try and spam their terminals. This is like my favorite technique. Catting devu random into their PTY device, and then their entire terminal and their whatever SSH section they're in just goes like haywire with all the output. And it's so funny because you can hear the terminal, like the alarm or the bell escape character going through. So there was a team behind us that would be like ding 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 ding, and it was like, oh man, we're hurting some people.
You could hear people like, oh god damn it.
Yeah, there were. A lot of angry people.
It was fantastic. Another thing you did, I know I heard some other people talking about it, was you replaced or you aliased Cat. to Ben True.
Yes.
So that whenever they tried to get the flag, they get on the machine, they try and cat the flag, and it would just return nothing. They'd be like, the flag file's empty.
And this is totally...
And the person writing the CTF would be like, no, it's not. I just checked. The flag file's there. It's like, I catted it. It's empty.
I love this because we didn't change the flag. The flag's not removed. The content's all still there. You just can't cat flag.txt. Like, if you open it with anything else, you'd see it. Like, totally still within rules.
So then your idea... The second day with all these like evil little things we were doing, John's idea was like, hey, can we make this happen automatically? Can we just like have it all happen? So what we actually did, we went home that night, and so they shut the game off. You can't play it at night. But we went home and actually wrote a script. We called it Maintain. And basically what Maintain did is it logged on. After it logged on, it would go through and... I think the first thing it did was spam Debian random to everyone's terminals.
Make everyone stop.
It would put that in a background. It was a while one in Bash, and it would just put it in the background. And anytime a new PTY came up that wasn't from one of our IP addresses, it would just spam Debian random to that terminal. The next thing it did is it reset passwords on all of the accounts. So even accounts that you don't normally use, like LP or mail or sys and things like that. And it would reset all those passwords. It would patch or backdoor bin false and user sbin no login. So the way logging in works on Linux is the way to disable an account is you make their default shell either bin false or user sbin no login, and whenever they try and log in, it'll run that and then it just won't work. You'll disconnect. It won't actually give you a shell. Well, if you copy bin bash to those places, then even places that show no login or bin false will now be able to log in. So we change all those people's accounts passwords, and then we backdoored those binaries, and then all of a sudden we could log in as users like mail or sys and things like that. We also added them to to sudoers files, so that all those users were now administrators. And the last thing that I had added to that script was, at least for this part, was installing SSH if it wasn't already installed, because we had root access, so an SSH server. Then setting up SSH to disable password authentication and patching it so that every single user's authorized keys was our public key. So we had generated a public key for us as the red team, and we could then log in as any user with that private key, and all users had sudo access, and no one else could authenticate with a password or any other private key. So that gave us access to anything with SSH on, or able to run SSH. And then we continued writing scripts to automate some of this. For a couple of the challenges that had SSH access, you went in and like made a script that would just test that SSH access. And then if it was there, immediately send and run that script. Then do what? Yeah. So the buffer overflow ones that I had solved, there was a buffer overflow easy and buffer overflow hard. And so I had solved those challenges, and you end up getting basically an interactive shell over the same socket you connected to the service as. And so my exploit scripts then would automatically, after it gets a shell, like create a listener, stage the maintain script on that machine, run the maintain script in the background, and then drop you to a shell. So I had those kind of running as well, and just it would just automatically, as soon as we got access to anything, as soon as anything reset, would just send all those and start running the maintain script so that no matter what, no one could access. And then once that was done, we could like at our own leisure log in and patch the binaries or patch whatever we needed to do. So that was really nice. That was a huge help the second day.
Yeah, I was kind of doing those originally like by hand, which is quick scripts that I would put together, and they were like disjointed and not centralized. And I put them in the cron tab, and you might have been able to see earlier, I had opened up cron tab and someone had found it and messed with it, so they'd ruined all the paths. And then putting it together in like a formal script that I think is honestly awesome. It's like a good hammer for immediately finding access and then trying to maintain it or just kind of troll other people so we can work with it. That worked well. But you did a lot of stuff for the Windows one. Because you got your blue keep.
Yeah, so with the rolling resets, what was hard was, like, you would have to be the first one on the box, otherwise they would start killing you, and then you were fighting for the box, and that's never a good spot to be in. So we wanted to automate it. So that night, I was taking a crack at trying to automate the blue keep. And there's two, like, ideas I was kind of going after. I was going to either use Python and, like, interact with Metasploit and script it, or what I ended up doing was using resource files in Metasploit. So it's just Ruby. You set it up basically like if you think, oh, like set target and do all that stuff. You can then, when you're opening up MSF console, if you pass it in MSF console tack R the file, the resource file name, it'll just automatically start doing that. So not only did I do that, but I also wrote a batch script to like set up firewall rules to block other people out, and then like kill the malware that was on the box, because the CTF administrator had quote unquote malware on the box. That way he could get in the box, and then if the game was getting unfair, he could like fuck with us. But we found his malware, so we could kill his connections as well. But anyway, so like as soon as the box, it would like run through, set the parameters, set our hosts, change the room size, exploit. As soon as the exploit would run, it would upload the batch script for setting the firewalls automatically. And then once that was running, uploaded and executed, then it was like safe to be on the box without having to worry about getting kicked off the box. So that was kind of cool. The firewall rule script did not work exactly because Windows Firewall is batshit crazy. I'm still tweaking that because I want to know why it wasn't working. Because I would end up like setting default any rules for myself to be able to go back in, but then I couldn't re-exploit the box, which was annoying because I lost my connection once or twice, and then I was just locked out of the box. Nobody could get into it, and that was really annoying. I also ended up later in the game, when that was happening a couple times, I started playing with Covenant as well. So not only did I use Meterpreter to have like do all my stuff on the box, but we uploaded automatically with the resource script a Covenant executable, and then it would call back to our Covenant C2 server. That way, multiple of us could log in through a web interface and like control those boxes if we needed to do anything, which was cool just to play with SpectreOps' new tool.
You mentioned fighting over stuff with people, and I thought it was really funny at one point. I think actually in the end, I thought somebody else had solved the buffer overflow easy, but I think in the end I was the only one that solved any of the buffer overflow ones.
Because guy solved it locally.
Well, yeah. So there's a couple things. One, we were sitting there, and after I had gotten access to the buffer overflow ones, the source code was in the machine. And so I just went in, fixed the errors in their application, and then recompiled it, and it was there. I also recompiled them all with, like, I think one of them didn't have DEP on, another one didn't have ASLR. I don't remember. I recompiled them all as position independent with DEP and everything, so that even if I left a vulnerability in there, it would be much harder to do, and they had the wrong copy of the binary. I think one of them was also compiled as 32-bit, and I recompiled it as 64, so all of their exploits wouldn't work even if I left
nice.
It. but it was really funny. I was sitting there, and we were playing with stuff, and I heard the guy behind me. We were at the very front talking to Arash,
yep,
right?
Yep.
Arash. And he was like asking, he's like, well, like my exploit works, but then it won't work on the remote thing. And I heard him like talking back and forth with him for a little bit. I was like, okay, I told everybody at the table, I was like, I feel really bad. I have to go up there. I went up there. I was like, so your exploit might work locally, but the binary that's running on the remote system might not actually be the same one anymore. And he just kind of looked at me like, what? And I was like, I might have patched the system. And he was just like, oh. And we walked away. But it was funny, the other team that was right behind us, they posted a write-up of all their things. And I thought it was really funny. In their write-up, they mentioned, they were like, yeah, we could never get the buffer overflow to work, but we just had this script that ran constantly that would just connect to it and crash the service repeatedly. They were like, if we can't have it, no one can. They're like, we don't know how to actually get a shell from this, but it's not going to work for anyone else either. And I was like, that's fantastic.
I love that. Yeah. What was I going to say? You were talking about the stuff that you were working with Windows and the Covenant server and everything. That was with Pat, who was our other teammate who wasn't able to hang out with us for the video. He's busy studying for CISP, which I should probably do as well. when I was trying to use the Windows machine and starting the capture program with the Windows machine, I couldn't seem to get like a shell to be returned with an interpreter, and I couldn't for the life of me figure out why. So I would try to run like exec or execute or multi-command and stuff like that. And at one point, I accidentally wrote buffer overflow rather than butter overflow, or I included single quotes around the team name, and then apparently because it needed just your team name as an argument for the capture program, it showed up on the scoreboard as buffer overflow or butter overflow with single quotes, and then we weren't able to get those points. We just had like fake accidental ourselves up there. That was totally my bad.
At one point we realized it, and then the one with quotes kept going up. We're like, where is this running? Something is running somewhere, and we couldn't stop it. We're like, I don't know where this is running, but it's losing points for us.
Oh geez,
it was funny.
That mistake ended up making third place at one point in the first day.
Yeah, so on the first day, Yeah, on the first day, that team, we couldn't get it to stop getting points, and it overtook like three other teams before we could get it to stop, and so it ended up in like third place for a while.
Oh gosh,
the team that like didn't exist,
Pony IP.
Yeah, so we wanted to pivot because the reason that we ended up writing those like access or maintain scripts rather than kind of the dirty doing it by hand was because by the end of the first day, one of the organizers came up to us and said like, "Hey guys, so what we're gonna do for tomorrow is we're actually gonna try and change the scoring up." It's honestly so that we can, so the winners that are winning are penalized and that the other players that are playing have kind of more of a chance to catch up. And Pat, it was so funny, was like, why? Like, why you literally penalizing the winners for winning? Like, what?
Yes.
And they said, yeah, so like, you know, other teams, like if Pony IP were to play tomorrow, they could still like realistically catch up, and like so it's mathematically possible. People don't just walk in and say like, well, there's no way to do this, this is stupid, and they just rage quit. And I was like, okay, yeah, we totally get that, sure, do whatever you guys got to do.
I think we talked about it a lot. Yeah. We got it if it was like a friendly CTF game. And then we were just playing for like notoriety,
yeah.
But because there was a cash prize, I think we were a little upset.
Yeah, we were dirty. So that night when we wrote all of our access and maintain scripts to just be like immediately grab stuff, immediately lock things down. The next day, that was all kind of in the effort to be like, well, we don't want anyone to catch us. We absolutely don't want to lose this lead. We have like 100,000 points in the lead, but it's still like possible if someone were to break into other machines and nest stuff down. That morning when we got back there, we were thinking, oh, yeah, let's. They wanted to make sure if someone else not in the lead has like a bonus, or they get more points when they capture, and the winning team gets less points when they capture. Julian had the sinister idea, well, like, let's just make another team that gets the bonus points. And we're like, oh, that's a good idea. There's nothing to stop us from that. And we were thinking about it and be like, oh, did you want to chime in?
To be fair, so. When we have these ideas, we always, like, in CTFD, there's usually, like, an ethics or, like, a rules page. If there's no rule page, then everything is fair game.
Oh, yeah.
And that is accepted within the community. It's, like, whatever is in the rules page, you don't mess with, like, don't attack the game server, don't, like... But if the organizer fails to put anything in the rules page, anything's on the table.
Hey, they gave me access to a network, and they didn't tell me it was in scope, so everything's in scope. That's all I'm saying.
So we made this second team, and we thought, like, well, the organizer had said...
Now I see the answer to the .net.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Damn it.
Now, the organizer had said, like, hey, if Pwn IP were to play the next day and they wanted to catch up, it's still possible for them. So we're like, you know what, yeah. Let's make our second team name Pony IP, just to be a jerk. They're like local rivals to us, so it was kind of like just a fun poke around. We could do something like Margarine Underflow or like other play on our names or something random. But we went with that, and we set it up so that our maintain script would not only run our capture script for our actual team, but also for the Pony IP team. And then it got on the scoreboard and it was scoring points, and the guys, the organizers and the segments of the Pony IP team that were there doing other things, they were hosting their own workshops, so they weren't playing. They had like, oh, geez, thanks for getting us on the board, guys. And then because they're kind of tight with the actual maintainer and the guy that hosted the CTF, they would be like up on stage, like entering whatever SQL commands they needed to like bump up their points, or they actually made sure that Pony IP was ahead of us for a little bit in the scoreboard. And it was just like a stupid fun.
They went up by like 100,000 points in one iteration of the scoring.
Yeah.
And we were like, what the hell just happened? We like looked up at Arash. We're like,
come on. What?
It was funny.
Yeah.
So I think there was two boxes we didn't end up solving.
Right.
One of them was you had a pop Hefe. Hefe was...
We actually got Hefe.
Well, but you had to use Hefe to get to the other one.
Yes.
How do we get Hefe?
Well, I actually had it up there. Was a React application that was theoretically running in debug mode. Looking at the source in the JavaScript, you could find literal SSH credentials. So we ended up using our access script that maintains stuff to force ourselves in there immediately on a reset or a revert. And that way we were able to kind of actually maintain our persistence and get stuff done. That one was interesting because it was just a regular user, but for the privilege escalation for Hefe and Elise or Sandra or whichever one other one was with the Y serial, they were both container privilege escalations. So Hefe, you had access as Docker, so you could just create a Docker instance where you had root access to the rest of the file system, and then you could get the flag there and edit sudoers and actually privesc. And Sandra or Elise or whatever the one that one was with LXD. So I really actually want to make other videos kind of tailored to this stuff, not just in this lightning speed video, but actually showcasing that technique with the Docker privesc or with the LXD privesc. So that, more to come. The other machine, Hans, that Julian was getting at, you needed to get into through Hefe or something.
So Caleb and I were kind of speculating. We were thinking maybe it was you had to like go in through the SSH tunnel.
So yeah, the organizer implied that when you actually scanned Hans, you saw nothing open. The organizer implied that Hans was actually SSHing to Hefe. And we realized that toward the end. There is a way that you can hijack that connection, which I've done before. We didn't end up actually trying to implement that. But likely that's what it seemed like was happening. We were trying to use PSPY PSPY to watch incoming SSH connections. The problem was our maintain script was flooding processes and we couldn't see it. Bottom line was we couldn't see it.
Couldn't we have just like read the auth log?
Maybe, but that wouldn't tell us what exactly they were running.
But it would tell us if they were SSH.
Yeah, the auth log could have told us, you're right. We were trying to see what they were running or what was happening. Maybe they were SCPing a file back to themselves. I know, yeah. I've seen that on like Hack the Box or whatever.
Oh, that'd be fun.
You can also hijack that connection sometimes if you have a malicious SSH server. Sometimes you can hijack the connection, which it is essentially malicious because we owned Hefe. but that being said, we never actually got that. Our PSPY process listing was flooded by our maintain script. But
you can see up on the kind of top left of my terminal, those are our access and maintain scripts working. Access would try and automatically log in with SSH pass and then copy our maintain script over to it and then run the maintain script, sort of flood everything else and make that box ours.
And that was another thing we kind of felt guilty about, was because we automated all of our exploits, like unless the other team had also automated their exploits, you had 0.5 seconds to pack into it before us, before we would lock you out.
I didn't really feel bad about that because it was a competitive game with an actual
prize. I mean, it's a King of the Hill game, so that's like just the nature of it. When I talk with some of the organizers and just saying like, it'd be really cool if these boxes had other pathways to get into it or other vulnerabilities or other attack vectors, so there wasn't always just one hole to break in, but there were multiple things to kind
of... Yeah, you might get in, patch the way you came in, but you didn't even know about another vulnerability that another team was using to get in. That would make it a little more competitive, I think. What they ended up deciding on was hourly resets. I think at the end they were like, okay, people are getting in and locking this down too quickly, let's hourly reset to let everyone kind of and catch up. So that was good. I thought that was an okay solution in the moment, but
The only other box we didn't get into was a .NET serialization one, which we ended up
figured
it out just after the end.
Well, we never knew what port to access. The problem was it was all through RPC, and so it was like one of the random RPC ports that was open was actually some kind of .NET deserialization thing that we never noticed.
There was a reference in the hint, and it was like, hey, there's this GitHub project for .NET serialization. You find the .NET serialization thing for that CVE. You had to install a bunch of .NET onto your computer and then compile his tool. Once you had his tool compiled, you could use it to essentially exploit it. But the problem was we weren't familiar enough with it. This is fun.
Yeah. Well, we'll talk about that in a second.
So we ended up writing the whole thing, and you should be able to like leak the version. It's a very straightforward exploit once you know all the parameters, but we didn't know what port it was on. And then you also have to specify the object, which like 10 minutes ago in the video, I saw the object and it finally clicked like how you were supposed to know that. But if you would have specified the object and then the port, it would have been a very simple for us to exploit box, but we just weren't familiar with the tool, and his documentation he's the only one who's created a tool, so it's awesome, but it's not very straightforward if you've never done it before. So
yeah.
Whole points to learn.
The other thing that we found kind of on accident, and I'm still a little confused how exactly it showed up.
Yeah.
So Arash tried to explain to us how some misconfiguration happened for about 30 minutes in the morning of the second day, but it happened nonetheless. And what it allowed us to do, if you pause it real quick.
Yeah, oh, sorry. I can go back to it.
So what it allowed us to do, Pat actually accidentally stumbled on it, was leak the source to the actual scoring server. So we mentioned earlier, if you don't put rules or scope or IP addresses on your frequently asked, I told him that we found this too. If you don't put rules or scope on your CTF like rules of engagement of some sort, you just put us on a subnet and told us to hack things. So I'm gonna break everything. So Pat leaked this source code. I never got it working, but I'm pretty sure it could have been done given more time. I was working on like the last like 30, 45 minutes of the CTF. But his scoring server, there's no authentication. When you run the actual capture binary, all it does is make a GET request to the scoring server with your team name, and it uses whatever the source IP of that GET request packet is as what machine you're scoring ports from. So if you run it and the source IP is Hefe, for example, yeah, then it will score points for you on Hefe. It has a whitelist of IPs at the top, which you can't really scroll around in here, which is fine. But it has a whitelist of IPs at the top that are all of the actual target machines in the network, along with some extras. And he actually mentioned when I talked to him later, he's like, yeah, all those extra machines are just in case I need to spin something else up and then we don't have to go back and modify it. I was like, okay, well, so what if I create a packet and just throw it on the wire that says that it has the source IP of that thing? That doesn't really work over wireless. I'm not a big wireless dude, so there's reasons why that doesn't work that I don't know. But it doesn't work over wireless. There's probably some security thing going on there. I don't really know. However, all of the machines in the game network are on a switch together. So theoretically, if we take one of the machines we've already compromised, we should be able to spoof packets onto the switch with a source IP address of anything we want. I tried for a little while to get it to work, but it's kind of annoying, and I'm not really good at crafting those packets because you need to craft the entire communication with correct TCP flags and everything with the communication with the server. It should theoretically be possible, though. I also dropped a couple of the machines off the network by accident because I was trying to add secondary or tertiary IP addresses onto one interface because you can theoretically do that in Linux, but what I ended up doing was just dropping it completely off the network by accident. And I was like, oh, that's down. It'll come back up in an hour when he resets everything. but it was interesting. It was fun. Again, it goes back to if you're hosting a CTF game, whether it's in the frequently asked questions page, whether it's just on the homepage, like put a rules of engagement that specifies do not touch our scoring server or I will touch your scoring server.
I just thought it was awesome. I just thought it was hilarious. Like, oh, we found the source. It just verifies based off IP address. Like, can we break that? Like,
yeah,
can
we tried a few different things. Everything? We tried like using exported four HTTP headers to see if that would trickle through and make it think we were coming from somewhere else. We tried Xreal IP, a couple other things, but whatever service they were, or whatever framework he was using, like checks that. So
had we been actually losing, we kind of discussed it towards the end. We could have spun up a virtual machine since we had root access on all these boxes and added another machine or added another NIC and then used one of the IP. We didn't have to actually spoof the IP address. We could have just set it to a static and then actually just used the unused boxes, and hopefully you wouldn't have noticed. But
yeah, so that is another thing. Any of those machines that were on Linux, theoretically, we had sudo access. There was internet on them. We could have spun up KVMs and done all of that. that would have been interesting as well.
What else was pretty fun about the CTF? Oh, you want to talk about the miscellaneous challenges that you had?
Sure. So once we got into Hefe, Hefe was the only one that had some bonus flags. There was one bonus flag, like an et cetera password, that was kind of easy to see. I just grabbed that there. There were some others in the source code. I wanted to kind of pause here so I can show you guys that, yeah, this is me trying to do the actual privilege escalation on Hefe. I'm using my little upload with Netcat script. That's all the stuff that I built and put together in the Poor Man's Pentest. So a little side for that, Poor Man's Pentest was a talk that I put on at B-Sides Nova. It seemed to be a really good success there. Also put it on at B-Sides Delaware, so go check that out. It gives you a little bit of functionality between managing a reverse shell and getting some scripted, quote-unquote, functionality and code in there. But I ended up getting the Docker command and Docker image and container to actually give me root access on Hefe, which was super duper cool. And again, I want to make a video on that so you can see me now giving myself real access and setting up the maintain script for that machine that we just broke into. And you could probably see it on the scoreboard, Pony IP is starting to climb up or slowly creep with those new 100,000 points.
Another, you want to talk about how you found the malware?
Oh, sure. So this is something that I had kind of done previously in a Windows environment. This was back to like CDX days when I wanted to have a service that would like rotate passwords every minute for some stupid, not creative reason. So I found in an older life, in a previous life, the NSSM or NSS, yeah, the non-sucking service manager. So it's another service manager you could pull into a Windows environment and it'll act like services for you. So I saw that in the PS output looking at that Windows machine that Julian broke into with Bluekeep, and I realized like, oh, that must be what's being used to kickstart this like agent service.exe. And that was Arash's C2 or command and control to actually fend us off and try to keep the Windows machine and boot us away, etc. So I could see the agent service.exe, which was pretty clearly what he was using it for, his backdoor, his rootkit, and NSSM to actually kickstart that over and over again. So I noticed once you delete those two, okay, he's gone. We flooded him out. So.
They had some other questions about doing reverse engineering on his malware. We didn't really get into that very much. I answered one of them because it was a fairly straightforward. It was asking like how he was injecting threads into a remote process, and that was fairly simple to find in Ghidra. And then the other question was asking about the XOR keys he was using, but that required more in-depth analysis that at that point was either wasn't helpful or too much work to really merit me going through all of it. It was going to take a little bit to actually figure out what was actually going on in that binary.
So specifically, the XOR key I asked him at the end, it was not brute forcible, which is mostly like most, I don't know, C2 malware is like 1 or 2 byte XOR, so you can like brute force it really quickly. But his, I think he said it was a 25 byte XOR, so
yeah,
we would have had to actually reverse engineer the malware.
And that's what he wanted people to do. We had such a lead at that point, and I was like, this is going to be a ton of work, to be honest.
This is when Julian had gotten command execution with the YSO serial. He kind of sent me that payload, and I started to move around with it. Just earlier when you saw me, the Windows VM, that was me trying to set up that .NET tool to try the .NET deserialization. But we never ended up getting anywhere with that. So.
Cool beans.
Do we have anything else we want to talk about this game?
Trevor, do you want to come join in and be like...
Trevor's been lurking in the
background. Yeah, Trevor's been sitting off on the side.
Get in here.
Hey, buddy. Welcome. Welcome. Tell us about your game.
So, you may have mentioned or not, there was 3 CTFs that were going on. There was the monetized one, which I assume was the challenging one here.
Where's that check?
There was the Skyline CTF, which I think was the inner... It's on the floor.
Yeah, it's back there.
You got trash on the floor. And then there was the, I think, newbie-focused CTF that Caitlin and I were working on. And that was a fun one. That was, so these types of competitions aren't really my domain, what I do on a day-to-day basis. I do more strategy, automation, designs, systems architecture, or security architecture. And so getting in here and being able to do the challenges was really fun. It was a lot of learning experience. A lot of you sitting around the table were able to help us while listening to Pat just ask the Arash. Just wonder what he's doing up there trying to knock you guys off the systems.
Yeah.
And then wondering why you're knocking him off the systems. So the newbie CTF that we were doing, there was a war game like section to it, which was really fun. It was a lot like
that was
Bandit.
Like Bandit over the
wire,
right?
It was like Bandit on Over the Wire, and I had a lot of fun with that one because it's more systems administration misconfigurations, and I know how to tackle those with my engineering systems engineering background experience. So Caitlin and I were working through that, and she and I actually found a few features or misconfigurations in their setup there. So like level 6, you could actually achieve capture the flag when you were level 3, and then by getting to level 16 or so, there was a privilege escalation file that actually just went and catted the flag in the next user's folder, but you couldn't do that because it couldn't, the file couldn't, the binary couldn't read the flag when it was supposed to.
Oh, no.
And then it was the last challenge was level 22, and that just didn't work at all, so they just gave us the flag. a lot of the other ones was crypto-focused, which when I realized Alfred was playing the CTF and he won number one, he is the AWS crypto guy, and he's a frequent crypto CTF black badge winner, and nice. I think he's on the ShmooCon crypto CTF badge challenge. So
nice.
Once I realized he's playing, I was like, all right.
It's game over. So Alfred took first, Caitlin took second, you got third?
I did. That's awesome. I didn't realize I got third.
Well, it's good to play.
I just heard my name up on stage. I'm like, what?
What?
So, and then a lot of the other challenges were, categories of challenges were very similar to the ones you're talking about here, just significantly easier. I didn't actually know this, but images.google.com, you can do a reverse image lookup.
Yeah. Yep.
It's like, all right, that's cool. Really, we had to go out and look in some different areas around the world just to find some hint of a flag. I'm like, oh,
that's cool.
That's kind of neat.
That CTF is put on by the same guys that are Pony IP, that rival kind of local team that we play against. It's a friendly rivalry.
It was really cool because they put it on as a workshop this year.
Yeah.
So like they walked the first day of the workshop, they like walked everybody through how to do all these things so they could learn. And then the second day they ran it competitively so people could reinforce all those skills they learned the first day. So hopefully they took good notes. Otherwise they had to remember how to do everything.
All right, cool. I guess I'm out of footage. That was 33 minutes of lightning speed, breakneck fireworks of hacking, or at least hitting the backspace key like 70 times.
That's what hacking is.
Break it.
Yeah.
I almost broke my computer.
Your backspace key is your most frequent key.
It is.
You did break your computer. Like,
we don't need to talk. We don't need to talk. I kind of broke my computer.
Midway through the competition, he decides to take his computer apart to replace the thing because he broke it.
The palm rest assembly screw posts had broken, so I bought a new palm rest assembly. It came in that evening, and I was like, oh, cool, I'm going to replace this, which requires removing the entirety of the internals of the computer and detaching the monitor from the laptop and then putting it all back together, which I did, except that I broke a clip on the touchpad ribbon cable that connects to the motherboard, and now my touchpad doesn't work.
I was watching this whole thing. I was dying inside. I'm like, there's not enough anxiety medication for me to be able to sit through this. He's going to break it. He's going to fuck something up.
It was all
He's
fine.
He's not
going
to be able to put it back together.
It was
and
all
he did.
Fine. And then that little tiny clip, the whole thing was fine. Other than that little tiny clip popped off, and now the ribbon cable doesn't stay.
Which we found.
I did find the clip, yeah.
We're going to have to go to a backup laptop for you.
No, I had a Bluetooth mouse. It was, plus, who uses a mouse anyway?
You couldn't get your computer to boot.
Oh, I would have just went and bought another one and then returned it.
Bought a new computer?
Just returned it the next day.
Yeah. So I want to applaud you guys and give you kudos on the automation script that you put together.
Thanks.
Yeah.
So like 10 years ago when I first started working professionally, we didn't even call it automation then, or it wasn't commonly called that. It was probably still, it was named after, like, I think Ford put it together, auto, whatever. It's two combo words that became together to be automation, like something operations. But we called it the lazy admin method, which was if you're going to do it twice, you may as well script it.
Yeah.
So good job.
It's true. Yeah. That's how I feel about everything.
Automotive operation. That's what it was.
So let me wrap it up. I know a lot of people will comment on this video and be like, dude, John, this doesn't help me whatsoever. I can't follow a video that's at 1600 times speed. I know. I'll try to put together some actual kind of tailored and specific videos for some of the techniques in here. We might put together, I know Caleb's got some good ideas bumping for that, the WISO serial attack and kind of brute forcing payloads to get a callback, which would be really cool. Julian, if you put anything together for some of that resource scripts and Metasploit to get Bluekeep up and running, like, on the fly, that'd be kind of cool.
Yeah,
so, there's a lot going on. Thank you guys for watching. B-Sides Noble was an absolute blast, and it was very, very cool and a lot of fun. So thanks for watching.
Rock and roll.
I can't close the webcam at this distance, so I'm just going to have to hit the bye button. Bye.
Bye.
Continue with your nonsense.
Which little piggy went to the
this
market?
This little piggy went to the market. I can't wiggle each toe, though. It doesn't, like,
bother you.
I can't. I'm not a monkey.
What was that thing you were doing a minute ago?
What?
I was like... You got some good audio there.
It's Stay hydrated, boys and girls.
This year's
want anything from 712?
Who? Kayla?
No.
Kayla?
You can't figure out a button combination.
If you grab some taquitos, I'll eat them.
No.
Taco.
Taquitos. Taquitos. Taquitos.
Trevor might bring some taquitos from 7-Eleven because he was like, you want anything? And I was like, I mean, if you buy taco taquitos, I'll eat them, obviously. Head bent over. Raise up posterior.